That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Part of the reason that people get into this 50th anniversary is because there's a lot of people who are really interested in NASA and really interested in this moon stuff, but it was also a time when we always that we came together. So there's some nostalgia for the 50s and 60s, the good parts of the 50s and 60s. So it was a tremendous time for one thing to sort of take over and really captivate everybody on the Earth, with millions upon millions of people watching the first time that anybody ever stepped foot on another object, and everybody on Earth wants to know about it. So there is a lot that we do know about the moon, but there's just as much, or if not more, that we don't know about the moon. A lot of the things that we don't know about the moon are kind of fundamental, as in where did it even come from? We have an idea of where that came from. The moon could have formed, it's the leading hypothesis, from the giant impact theory, where a Mars-sized object called Theia crashed into the Earth. So this was common early in the solar system, but it crashed into the Earth, peeled off a large chunk of the Earth's crust that ended up in an orbit, or orbital ring around the Earth that eventually coalesced into the moon. The Apollo missions brought back quite a lot of rocks. The first Apollo mission brought about 50 pounds of rocks back. So it's basically like a briefcase filled with rocks. But since then, with the other additional missions, we were able to bring back quite a few rocks. And many of them have been tested in labs, but some of them NASA kept sealed away, because you're coming from the vacuum of space, so they're all nice and sealed. But here on the Earth, we don't want it to interact with the atmosphere, so they've kept them protected. And recently, they've just been talking about releasing a set of specimens from that protected set of rocks that moon researchers can go after new geology questions. And these were set aside originally because 50 years ago, we didn't know what questions to ask. One of the mysteries was, will these rocks explode and cause fire if they are exposed to oxygen? We didn't even know that. We thought that the astronauts would sink up to their knees in lunar dust. So there's a lot of things that we learned, and because we were just finding out about what was going on, we could do a lot of testing, but they had the foresight to say that, you know, in 50 years, they'll have different technologies and they'll be able to ask different questions that we don't even know we need to ask. And so saving that was actually really smart. Apollo 11, the other Apollo missions, planted a flag for the United States onto the lunar surface. The sun has been irradiating it since the Apollo missions, so that's 50 years. And we know what happens when we lay stuff outside here on the Earth. It just bleaches it white, so the flag is most likely to be white. When we left the Earth, we went out to discover the moon. But when you come back and you turn around, the only thing that you can see is the Earth as a whole thing. You don't see it as, here's Ohio. You don't see it as, here's just the United States sticking out. It is the Earth. And to be able to see the entire Earth as one unit, as a single fragile ecosystem that is all connected, was pretty powerful. But it's one of those things that it made us really realize what we had, because it's so much smaller than what you experience on a given day. While you're wandering around Columbus or Ohio, you think, oh, this Earth is enormous, and there's nothing that I can do to make this planet worse or better. But really, we are a tiny, tiny ecosystem in a very vast, empty space.